look, he's got one left.
Realization comes in, oh my god, they're going to speak three times. It's only the second. So if you think it's bad now, just wait till after lunch. So we would like to pick up on another topic now, which is understanding the male-female dynamic. This work comes from the, is if you like, the core insight or IP that came out of the marriage seminar that we were part of, I guess, developing in the late, in about 1990. And this particular insight, I think, at the time was radical. You can now find it in different places, but we've yet still to see it really unpacked completely clear, as clearly as it could be. And we, of course, have never written a book because we're too busy. So we thought we'd share this with you. So this content today comes in two forms for you. It comes in, I think, an important insight that you'll all have parts of, and some of you will, it'll be old news to some extent, that helps you in the work you do. Because it's the key insight to male-female intimacy, which is what marriage is. But it also comes to you for your own personal benefit. And no matter how often you've heard this before, the question always to ask yourself is, if I do know this, how am I living it? And if I haven't heard it before, what is it telling me? So this is a little bit of your own journey, an inward journey, and also a journey for your own work.
So a good place to start is to think about some of the easily observable differences between men and women, boys and girls. And you might like to just buzz around your tables for a minute, but consider things like the behaviour of children, your career choices, or your recreational preferences as just sort of starting points to just kind of get our heads into the space of, okay, look, men and women are in fact actually different and it's okay. So we'll give you a couple of minutes just to buzz around your table.
2 minutes at the table. What are the key things that tell you that men and women are at a fairly fundamental, quite different? You can have some fun with this if you like, but 2 minutes, go.
Right. Men are from Mars and women are from Venus.
Thank you. everyday life, there's demands that extend our human, not weakness, but our weakness, vulnerabilities. And that's when I mean the extravagant mercy of God and the mercy of Monica for me and me for her is so important and so essential to me, to the survival of the marriage and to make it more fruitful.
Those weathered lines are the workings of the relationship, not just age. There's nothing quite like looking at a couple who have lived that long together to really talk about knowing. They don't need to say many words, actually. You just know that they know. So
men and women are different.
No, they're not. It's not true. It's really not true. You prove that it's not true, right? You're sure that it's not true.
So we're doing a variation of this talk just recently for the seminarians in Sydney, and we asked them for feedback. We're a little bit too big here today for the feedback, but one of the seminarians told us that his brother and sister-in-law were determined to give their children gender-neutral toys. So they gave their little daughter a truck and left her to play with this truck. And they left the room, they came back in, and she had carefully tucked it into bed.
We had our son and daughter up at Dunk Island when we were young, having a bit of an escape holiday when we only had two kids. And our eldest is a daughter, and 18 months below her is her younger brother. And I can't quite remember the ages, but I think he must have been about 3 and a half, about 4 maybe at the time. And she's a little bit older, and so she's much more mature, and she's a girl. And she finds a piece of stag corn coral on the beach. And she picks it up and says, "Oh, look, it's a beautiful piece of coral." And it's sort of got a Y angle in it. And she hands it to her little brother, who looks at it for a minute, puts it in his hand like a gun, and goes, "Pew." I don't care what people think. We were the same in the 1990s. We were going to be perfect 1990s parents, and then our kids taught us what reality was. When we started our work in marriage, we were newly married. It was about 1991. And it was still quite controversial to say men and women were different, because we were coming out of that era of everyone's... that people heard it as unequal. And then John Gray wrote Men Are From Mars and Women Are From Venus. And I have a love-hate relationship with John Gray. I love him because he actually made it permissible to talk about difference again. And for a long period of time, we actually relished in that. And it became quite normal, and everybody would nod in the room. And now we seem to be going back to that same place, where the confusion between equality and difference clouds our conversation. But anybody who's been married knows in their heart that it is a fundamentally different relationship. I think God's ultimate sense of humour is that he put us into a reality where a man and a woman wanted to spend their life fully committed to each other, with the impossible outcome that they try to understand each other. And when we talk to young adults, young boys and girls, high school age, about marriage, etc., almost invariably, some smart aleck in the back of the room, eventually, you can almost wait to see it come, and puts his hand up and says, "Don't you get sick of sleeping with the same woman every night?" And I look at him and say, "Mate, I sleep with a different woman every night. I don't know what the hell I'm in for." And they all go, "Oh my God, they can't quite work out what's going on." But it's true.
Those hormone changes are hell, aren't they?
No, it's true. I mean, you know, is she happy? Is she sad? Is she a monster? is she vulnerable? Is she warm and cuddly? Is she a volcano that's about to explode? And she doesn't come with signs.
Yeah, she does. You just don't know how to
wear it. Well, that's right. And no man does. And why don't you understand that, ladies? A Are you really that thick? Seriously, you expect us to understand. How long have you been married to me? No, but seriously, we are wired so fundamentally differently. And in that comes great joy and great pain. And so if we want to make this work and we don't understand it, then it's sort of like trying to open the bonnet of your car and deciding you're going to maintain it without a manual. Nothing good will come of that, gentlemen. And our wives are usually smart enough not to even think of doing that. So this is a bit of a quick guide to the most fundamental part of that relationship.
So one of the most important differences that we have as men and women is actually in the way that we interrelate with each other, the way that we love. And in fact, I mean, we've had that put to us that the definition of spirituality is just the way that we love. It's our way of loving is a way to describe spirituality. And so in a very real way, men and women are different at these fundamental spirituality levels. And of course, the most important point to remember about our differences is that they are complementary. Yes, they are real, and that's a good thing because it allows us to complement each other. That our differences enable us to bring out the best in the other person. Particularly, I think it's helpful to identify within men and women some of the core characteristics for relationship that make us, I guess in some ways, different but experts in different aspects of relationship. So for women, you know, we can very much see, I think, that we're attuned to the emotional cues in others. Women seem to have this almost sixth sense that is sending out like a sonar, an invisible kind of detection system to measure the emotional level of the other person or the other people in the room. And we seem to just be really finely attuned to the emotional cues that are coming back, whether it's our children or our spouse. And, you know, we'll often have conversations where I'll say, "What's going on? You don't seem right." And I can't quite put words on exactly what it is, but something doesn't feel right. And sure enough, there'll be something that Byron's musing on that he, you know, is trying to not distress me, doesn't, he's worried, but he doesn't want to make me worried, or he's upset with me, but he's trying to be manly and not sort of show, or whatever it has to be. I think, does that resonate with you, that this kind of capacity for women? That's not to say men can't do that, but I think women just have a particularly finely attuned ability for that. I think we also have a great gift of presence. We women know that we're together, that one of the great gifts that we can give is just be totally focused. And maybe it gets bred into us from, you know, when we're little and we're looking after children and we're nurturing them, we're feeding that baby and we're totally present to that baby, even though it's totally present to just a part of us, the bit that's feeding us. But we get that kind of the gift of presence. We're natural nurturers, and this comes from, I think, just our bodies get flooded with oxytocin through the process of childbearing and breastfeeding. You might have heard oxytocin is referred to as the bonding hormone. Men also, by the way, get oxytocin, but they experience it at climax. Women experience it also at climax, which is why sex is bonds us psychologically. It's not just a, you know, something you can do on a one-night stand and move on from. And I think also we have a deep value for beauty. So in most homes, you'll find that the person out of the couple that's most attuned to decorating, whether it's putting up the Christmas tree or making things tidy or beautiful, is usually the woman. Again, you get
exceptions. Our lawns are beautiful.
But that's not fair.
No, they're beautiful.
They were beautiful. Here, I have a dog.
That's sort of a special guy. What about
me? So, yeah, we're speaking in generalisations, and generalisations are helpful because they are generally true. So we all have some aspect of this, but men tend to be much more attuned towards the notion of protection and service. So the protective nature of men is very strong. You ask any husband, would he take a bullet or step in a bus to save his wife? It wouldn't cross his mind. There was that massacre.
He would. You mean he would.
Sorry, he wouldn't have to think about it. It's innate. Men walk into danger for somebody else, they don't think much about it. No, and we laugh at them and say, aren't they stupid? Actually, no, it's innate. We are highly protective.
I could just tell a funny story. Have we got time for a story?
A quick one.
So we're in Italy for 3 months on this kind of sabbatical with the kids.
Can't tell that story.
And you can buy baby guns over there.
Soft rubber.
In a toy shop. So our kids are like, yeah, let's get some baby guns. So, I think you need to pick up the story.
So, anyway, I let the boys, who were, I don't know what they were, 11 and 12, buy these pistols, airsoft pistols that shoot these rubber bullets, which are illegal in Australia. And they think...
For good reason.
They think this is great. And having bought, let them buy these things, I thought, irresponsible father, I better check how safe they are.
So, I took this thing.
Check.
I took this thing. And I shot myself in the leg with it. point blank. And I went, well, I better see if this is safe. I went, bang, osh! Oh, yeah. And he's looking at me like, are you mad? Yeah, that's what you do, right? Guys? Explains a lot about me. So anyway, we are very attuned to provision. So a lot of men are criticised for always being out of the home, working too hard, you know, chasing the dollar, immersed in their work. Most of the motivation for that, sometimes it's escapism, sometimes it's attachment. But for most good men, most of the time, that is their innate sense of providing for their family. When we bought our first home, and we had been searching for a long time, and Francine was out every Saturday, you know, going through the papers, and we were looking, and if you know anything about property prices in Sydney, they're always depressing. And we finally bought our first home, and Francine's immediate reaction at the auction at the Hammerfield was, got our home.
It's a relief.
And mine was, there's the next 35 years of my working life. I was happy, I wasn't complaining. But our translation of the consequence of that was fundamentally different. I run a spreadsheet because I'm an analyst. I run a spreadsheet for our financial situation for the family. It runs out for Francine's financial. Francine's 6 years younger than me. It runs out to 100. I think about providing for Francine till she's 100. And she will probably be dead before me. And Francine thinks... Sorry, you'll be dead before me. Yes, sorry. I will be dead before you. She might take that gun and shoot me. So, gentlemen, bye, guy, Sue. It wasn't an accident. No, but seriously, I mean, it's... And Francine commented this one day. She said, you've run it out to 100. And I sort of didn't think twice about it.
I'm sort of thinking, long-term planning for me is like the next 5 years. Long-term planning for him is the next 40 years.
So we are quite different in the way we approach the paradigm of life. We are quite different the way we approach caring. We are quite different the way we approach loving. And so for men, we take value and we see value in things like strength. We actually take value in things like hierarchy. We try to understand how things work, not because we want to be the powerful person in the room, but we understand protective systems work around hierarchy. It's innate. So my son came into my work. He was about 11 years old. He came in after school. And he walks into my office, and we walk around, and he's going to do his homework while I'm finishing up work, etc. And every time somebody walked into my office to catch up with me, because he's working at a table at the desk next to mine, he says, are you his boss? Are you her boss? Or is she your boss? And every time somebody came in, and 11 years old, this young male is trying to work out where I sat in the hierarchy. I don't think my daughter would have been doing that. Oh, she's pretty.
Nice.
He's nice. I don't know what she would have been thinking, but he was absolutely on hierarchy. So it's quite innate in what we do. Now, that's an important starting point, because we need to give ourselves permission to understand that the differences between us aren't coming from a selfishness, but they're coming from an innate way of how we relate. And therefore, everything that we seek to do and how we seek to love comes from my maleness or Francine's femaleness. And just the way we have cultural differences, and the cultural differences define us, and we have family upbringing differences, and they define us, This masculine and feminine difference is deeply, it's genetically formed in us, and it's carried in every one of us in one form or another.
You know, some recent study that was published was looking at the entire genome of the human person, and it compared the entire genome in men and women, and it found that around 32%, so almost a third of all genes, had a sexual difference. So even things like your liver is different in a woman and to what it is in a man. And so the differences are just embedded in our very being. Yes, 66% of us is the same genetically, biologically, but there's a 33% of genes have a difference in the expression related to our sexuality.
Now, there's thought number one. Thought number two, so if you're in intimate relationship as a man and as a woman, welcome to marriage, then you have a fundamental requirement to understand how you relate to a man or a woman and how that man or woman will relate to you if you want that to work. The second thing you need to understand about intimate relationships is intimacy can only exist where there is trust. Because intimacy is based on the preparedness to be vulnerable. You cannot have intimacy if you are not prepared to be vulnerable with the other person. So think about this in a work environment. We have plenty of relationships where we work functionally with people, but we aren't very vulnerable with them. We have some good friends at work and elsewhere where we might be much more open, much more sharing to our inner lives, but there will still be a limit to that. The place that we want to have the most intimacy and we desire the most intimacy is between each other. Therefore, we need to have the most vulnerability for that to occur, and we can only achieve that vulnerability if we trust each other. So the foundations of every marriage has to be built around a relationship of trust. Now, trust means many things. I trust you not to sleep with somebody else. I trust you not to abuse me. Yeah, okay, fine. That's a given. But do I trust you to be there for me when I'm actually not really there for myself? Will you know me? Will you be interested in me? Will you walk with me? Will you share with me your greatest fears and dreams? That's the intimacy that we ultimately look for. And that's the intimacy, and that requires a trust to do that.
So trust grows when our behaviour is consistent and loving. There's that kind of predictability or reliability about it. That's because it's loving, so it's a healthy kind of relationship, and it's also consistently so. Trust also grows when our emotional needs are met. So when somebody has a pattern of reliably responding to our emotional needs, that spontaneously we feel attraction to that person and gratitude and affection for that person, but it also helps grow our trust. I think the other important thing is when promises are fulfilled. And it's helpful, I think, to differentiate between explicit and implicit promises. So for example, our wedding vows were a very public, explicit statement of our commitment to each other. But there's also, I guess, some implicit agreements that we might always just assume that come with that. For example, about friendship or affection, that we assume that we are going to be company for each other. That wasn't explicitly said in the vows. So there's a whole lot of implicit sort of promises that come with this package of marriage that we haven't kind of necessarily articulated, but they're there nonetheless as a kind of an expectation. And all this is important in terms of building relational resilience. Resilience, we would describe this concept as kind of like a base load of goodwill between us. It's the presumption of loving intent, because we have this track record over the past of loving intent being reliable there. And when we've got this emotional resilience, we're less likely to interpret a careless gesture on the part of the other as being a hostile action. Also, our recovery is quicker. We kind of know, oh, okay, he said something that hurt me, but that's not what he's usually like. So I can forgive more easily, and we can kind of recover our sense of trust and well-being in the relationship and get that connection again much more quickly. So this idea of resilience, they talk about resilience a lot in education at the moment. It's one of the buzzwords in Australia, and I'm assuming it's the case over here. that they try to instill into kids this emotional resilience that they can, you know, cope with the knocks of life and be challenged and so on. I think we need to think about that and apply it into our relationships. How do we make our relationship resilient so that when the inevitable, you know, little knocks from internally or externally come along, we've kind of got that baseload of goodwill there that we can kind of fall back on and say, yeah, we can bounce back from this.
So trust is something you might start with a level of trust, and when you fall in love with each other, you probably trust each other a lot. So that's your starting benchmark, but then it either grows or it diminishes based on how you interact with each other. When trust is undermined, intimacy suffers. Because you are not prepared to be vulnerable with somebody you can't trust to be that they will handle that vulnerability. You just won't. So you might intend to, but you won't. And we know this in the workplace quite easily, but it applies very hard, very easily, and very importantly, it applies also with us in this relationship. We are more easily hurt when trust is undermined. Because now I don't sure what your motivation was because I don't trust you. There's a certain amount of, when you don't trust someone, there's a certain amount of fear involved. I don't mean we walk around in fear of each other. But by definition, the opposite to trust is a sense of fear or protectiveness. You're more likely to have an argument when you don't trust each other. Now, a little subtlety about arguments. We will disagree about many things, Francine and I. Of course we will. We are different people. We have different upbringings. We will disagree about lots of stuff. Doesn't mean we will always argue, but we will always disagree on something. Arguments are an expression of a disagreement. But you're more likely to argue about your disagreements when you don't trust each other. Because what you start to find doing is you start assigning motive. The motive to business.
We love this quote from Dr. Sue Johnson. She's an American family therapist. She says, arguments are a protest against disconnection. The subtext of every argument we have as intimates is, do you love me? Do you care about me? Does it matter to you what I think and what I feel? That's really what we're asking of the other when we're in the midst of an argument. The topic might be, you know, whatever, what movie we're going to see, or, you know, are you spending enough time at home, or should we send our kid to this school or that school, whatever the topic's irrelevant. When it escalates into an argument and there's kind of that energy thing happening, the subtext is, do you care about me? Because we've lost that connection and that sense of we're together as a team and we can resolve this disagreement because we're both on the same side. When we lose that, well, then all those questions come back up and they sort of sit in the background of our subconscious and they're fueling our defensiveness of our position about that topic. Because if I'm not sure you care about me, I have to hang on to my point of view even harder and I have to defend it. Whereas when I know and I feel trust, like that I can trust him and that I've got conviction that he cares about what I want and what I need, I can hold my opinion much more lightly. Hold it more lightly and with more flexibility. I can give and take much more readily.
We had a big argument, a long-running argument between us when we first bought that house we bought. It had a formal dining room in it. And a long story which we won't tell now, but ultimately at the end of the day we had to pick a dining room table. We had two completely different values about the sort of dining room table we wanted. So we had a natural disagreement. So we would argue every time we went out to find a dining room table about what sort of table we would have. It wasn't until we sat down and went deep into what was the value, what's going on here, what's the underlying value that we're both trying to solve for. We won't unpack the story now. But when Francine, I knew that Francine understood the value of what I was seeking for on that dining room table, I was completely happy for her to pick it.
Unilaterally.
It wasn't like, well, you pick it. It was, no, you get what I want. I trust you. You pick it. But until I knew she understood what I was trying to solve for and respected and honoured that, I was holding on to my position.
And just to put this into context, the first house we bought, we lived there for 8 years. It had a dining room. We never bought a dining room in that 8 years. We then bought a second house and renovated it. That took a further 2 years. and then it stayed unfurnished for at least a year after that. So we're talking about something that was running for 11 years of us trying to work out which time we were able to get.
See, we're just like the rest of you. We're as dumb as anybody. So if, when you have that trust, you can let go. But when you don't, you hold on. So trust...
You have to be your own advocate when you're not, when there's not a trust relationship, right? So we get defensive and put on our...
So let's bring these two thoughts together. Men and women fundamentally approach relationship differently. They're wired to approach relationship differently. And that relationship that they seek is based on trust. So how do you trust somebody when every time you think right, they think left? When you think go, they think stop. When you think black, they think white. Because that's sort of what's happening, right? We are very expert at two opposite ends of outlooks on the world. Francine as a woman is wired relationally. She has a radar that's going out and a sonar that's going out, relationship, relationship, relationship. I'm male, I tend to be wired objective outcomes, objective outcomes, objective outcomes. So we approach everything from two different paradigms. So when Francine says she wants to share something with me, I immediately think I have to fix something. And I look for a hammer. Because what else? How else do you fix it? Right? When I tell something with Francine, she's trying to understand what the relational implication is, and I'm just telling her something that we need to do. Or she wants to take it into a relational situation, which I'm thinking, what's the point of that? I want to go and mow the lawn. who cares about the neighbours? No, but we come at these things quite differently. So how do you bring these two things together? You have to have a relationship based on deep trust when actually your instincts are quite different for how you approach that relationship.
Okay, we want to now just take you to another little kind of thought piece that just helps build the picture. What happens when we have broken trust? What's the experience for women? What's the experience for men? And again, we can, experiences tend to be quite different.
So there's lots of ways we can experience broken trust between us. It can be all sorts of little things. But with our sexual difference, there are two deep ways we experience it. And we want to just look at that one at the moment, because this is something that will resonate more often than not in most of our experiences.
So psychologists call these the primal fears, or some of them call them psychic terrors. So what they're trying to get at is what is this foundational instinctive sort of reaction or defensiveness that is embedded in us? And for women, it's this articulated as an abandonment anxiety. Now this abandonment anxiety is rooted in our physical vulnerability. Especially if we're pregnant or we have young children in our care. The female species is biologically, on average, weaker and slower than men. And now that doesn't mean you don't get very strong.